maybe slightly different, and this is this idea of reflexivity. And really, I suppose what that's about is about the learner, why the learner is important in what we do in that education, and why the idea of reflexivity is a relatively new concept. The idea of putting the learner at the center of things, I think, has been part of the adult education mission. Okay. So, well, I should say meant part 6 rather than part 7, but meant part 6, part 7. Adult education was responding to that literature era, and at that time it was including people who had relatively high profile, really, in trade union movement primarily, and when they had very little access, I suppose, to formal education. And it turns out that these people went on to create a lot of important initiatives, and one of them was the Lord Mayor of the district that welcomed John F. Kennedy to Cork. So, I suppose what we're trying to say is that in 2022 we should be equally responsive to the year we're in. So, obviously, the times have changed, and we need to change in those times. And what I want to talk about tonight is this idea of reflexive modernity as being the era in which we live in now, and that adult education should really be bearing this in mind. And we hear a lot of talk about placing the learner at the center of what we do, but very often we don't do much about that, apart from saying, yes, this is what we should do, but we don't do much about it. There's also a lot of talk around skills and the skills agenda and so on. And very often, in relation to the skills and skills agenda, again, the learner is not really put at the center of it. It's more about kind of the top down model. And I would contend that the top down model is not really the way to go. Okay, so I think it's important for us to bear in mind where we are, and I suppose for the last 2 years or so, we were subsumed by the ideas of COVID and so on and so forth. But today we are involved in a terrible war in Ukraine, and half the audience tonight in Ukraine. I think that doesn't happen too often in UCC, they say. Exactly 50% of the people here are from Ukraine. So that would have happened 2 months ago. So it's a rather unusual circumstance. But that war is one that was first bear in mind. The war is about is against freedom of choice. It's been waged by a totalitarian regime which doesn't believe in democracy, human rights, civility, modern society. And it's against the self-determination of the Ukrainian people to choose their own form of government, their independence, and so on. And I think that's something that resonates quite well with an Irish audience as well, because we've been in that place too. So, in terms of lifelong learning and education, we can see the same thing as in relation to people having the options to make choices about their lives, and this is really important. And you know, at the weekend, last weekend, a young man in Dublin was attacked and brutally assaulted, and the reason this happened to him was because he was gay and due to his sexual orientation. And you think about it, you know, this is somebody whose right to be who they are is being denied by individuals. For whatever reason, it's not clear to me what the reason behind that could possibly be. But clearly, one of the things that causes this is people not really reflecting on their actions, not considering why they take actions, or considering, you know, all of the circumstances around this, and not considering that other individuals in society have a right to autonomy, self-determination, and so on. And I think this is a really important part of adult education in terms of trying to get people to be more effective, more critical, more analytical in terms of what they do. And also, in terms of that agenda, if we believe in the idea of self-determination, if we believe in the idea that people should have autonomy over the decisions they make, but then in terms of adult education, lifelong learning, then we have to also accept that learners have the right to choose what they want to learn. So this should be part of our agenda. And when we talk about putting the learner at the center of things, that's really what it should mean. But very often we don't do that. We decide for people what they should learn and why they should learn. So I suppose what I'm trying to do tonight is to challenge some of that thinking. So what is reflexive modernity? And we have a description here that's saying the best field of social experiment. So basically, the contention here is that we've reached a certain stage of evolution in modern society where people are taking more and more control over how they self-identify, how they see themselves. And those ideas around identity are complex. So maybe in the past you would think of people as fulfilling one kind of role or being one type of person or whatever. But nowadays people have several layers of identity in terms of who they say they are, who they understand themselves to be. And this is obviously has impacts. It has impacts in terms of how people understand themselves, but it also has impacts in terms of how we accommodate them. But also has impacts for the individual because maybe in a traditional society, you went through rites of passage and so on, and it was largely predetermined for you who you would be and what you would be. Now you are in a situation where you are in a scenario where there are lots of different options open to you. And the idea of choice can be quite challenging, and whose choice can actually lead to you know, a lot of difficulties for people trying to accommodate what they want to achieve in a situation where there seems to be an infinite number of options available to them. So in that regard, I suppose it's also important for us to be mindful of that and creating conditions where people can make informed choices. And then we also say through by forces like globalization. So there's, you know, obviously see that in every aspect of our society, the influences from right across the globe. It's also around weakening traditional norms and bonds and cultural understandings. So there's a whole new opening up, a whole sense of flux that wouldn't have been the case in the past. And if we are to respond to learners today, then we have to be conscious of that. So we can't use old models for a new scenario. And I think it's a nice phrase that Arthur uses here. So it says, he says, increasingly everyone has to navigate by the compass of their own personal concerns. You can see that this is a quite a challenging scenario for people. So now you no longer are, I suppose, shaped and molded by the society around you to the same extent. So obviously some of that is still occurring, but you know, the sort of the idea of the compass of your own personal concerns. So this could be around your sexual identity, it could be around your religious identity, it could be around what your interests are, the kind of music that interests you, the kind of art that interests you, the kind of activities you engage in, the kind of people you are friendly with, and so on. But I suppose everybody has an increased capacity to pursue this kind of an agenda. So, talk about self-generated internal discourse. So this is sort of like you figuring out in your own self what it is you want to be, and trying to figure out, you know, which options are best for you. Now, in terms of adult education, we have to be delivering our education in a way that it doesn't constrain people, that it still allows them to pursue their own dreams, hopes, and so on and so forth. And that's really important in terms of how we design courses, how we present them, and so on. And a lot of what we do is very rigid and circumscribed, and you know that is problematic. So, talk about the personal concerns and the conditions that make it possible to accomplish them. So, again, there could be a lot of, you know, difficulties here in terms of what you want to be and the extent to which it is possible to achieve your goals. And again, if you think about adult education, if adult education involves enabling people to achieve their goals, then by constraining them and by deviating them off into, corralling them into spaces they don't want to go to, it is actually a form of totalitarianism. It's a sort of form of repression. And the whole idea of adult education shouldn't be about repression, should be about liberating people, giving people opportunities. So it's about autonomy and choice making. And as I said, you know, making choices can be quite complex and difficult as well. So it's important, I suppose, that we help people in terms of their critical faculties and that. So for adult education, I'd say that it's about to be expansive rather than limiting. And I have to say that I struggle a little bit with learning outcomes, you know, and I know that's a very fashionable phraseology, and I know that even here in UCC, learning outcomes are kind of front and center of course design and so on and so forth. But for me, we need to be careful about an idea like learning outcomes, because learning outcomes assumes we know better than the learner where they need to get to. So, you know, there's a little bit of contradiction here. So, I invite us to treat learning outcomes with a certain level of caution. Say, is this really what we want to do? You know, if I'm out here in the quad and somebody asks me the way to City Hall, and I say to them, no, you don't want to go to City Hall. County Hall is much more interesting, it's a higher building. And you walk this way and you walk the Western Road and you see a big building in front of you. But that's not much good to the person. They say, well, it's City Hall I want to go to. And now you're sending them off to the County Hall. So you're sending them to the wrong place. So it's important for us to bear that in mind, that we shouldn't be over prescriptive in terms of what we want learners to do, where we want them to go. So we need to pull back a little bit from that. And we also need to help them to be more confident in their capacity to make decisions about themselves and about where they want to go in their lifelong learning journey. And again, this is a challenge because it's not so easy. It's really giving the people a sense that they can make decisions for themselves and that they might know better about their lives than I do or somebody else does. No. Very radical thinking here, but when you think about what we do, we very often make those decisions for people. So we decide for them, yeah, this is good for you, and you know, we're not really taking on board what the person themselves feels. So when we talk about putting the learner into the center of things, it's a pretty challenging concept and idea. And you can maybe understand why. Maybe people talk about it and maybe don't do it so much because it's not so easy. So, the idea of volunteer, suggested here, to be conjointly responsible for a process in which all go. So the idea here is that the teacher isn't really sort of the, you know, the person who's driving the agenda. They're part of the process, but they must have the confidence to let go and to allow for the learner to actually drive the agenda as well. So it has to be a collaborative process. So the educator is in a supportive role, and they have to resist the need to retain power. And to be honest, that's quite difficult. A number of us here have found ourselves at the top of the room teaching. I think, Victoria, maybe you haven't had this wonderful experience yet, but maybe the rest of us have. But you know yourself, when you start teaching a class for the first time, and you're doing a course for the first time, you really want to keep control, because you want to make sure that things doesn't just get away from you, and you don't want to be found out, and so on. So it can be quite difficult. So I'm not suggesting this is an easy road to go. It's quite challenging, and it requires you to be very confident that, you know, that you're able to let the process go. But if we're really serious about learning, then we have to do that, really.
Sorry, you're on me.
So, again, just to refer to theorists here. So, they talk about releasing a practice for generative conversations and concerted actions. So, what they're basically saying is that what we need to do is we need to create learning communities, learning organizations, in which people feel free to contribute to the learning process. And through this, they develop conversations and debates among themselves, and then they create a dynamic audience. And they also talk about enabling a process where frozen patterns of thought can be dissolved. And I want to go on that theme a little bit more, because I think this is part of our problem, that we have a lot of frozen ideas, frozen concepts, prejudices, preconceived ideas, the idea that something is such a way and it can never be any other way. And these are really debilitating ways of thinking, and we really need, as educators, to get past that, to give people the sense that just because something is this way and because it's been like this for 1,000 years doesn't mean it has to be like that forever. We can change. We can move on. And we can come up with new ideas. And again, this is kind of a Freirean idea. The idea of expressing ideas and challenging themselves and each other, where people can learn to learn together. And, you know, we see a lot of, progressive and experimental things being done in this space with very small children, where they can, you know, do a lot of critical thinking and a lot of analysis of situations and so on and so forth. And we should be doing exactly the same thing with others. We should be allowing them the space to engage each other, to challenge each other, and then everybody learns together. And that includes the person on the top of the room. The idea that the person on the room has all the knowledge, and they have all this to share, and it's kind of top down. We need to try and break away from that. So he's then in the top of the room and talking them into it. But anyway, maybe in why we organize this into groups and we start challenging some of these concepts and ideas. So, I don't think you can just play an urgent role in addressing not only specific skills and teams, but a wider imaginary. And this idea of imaginary is important. So it's us trying to imagine different ways in which we can see the world. The world is not just fixed in time and everything just the same forever. We need to enable learners to be critical, and this is really important. And again, referring back to the war, and you know, we discuss this very often, a lot of people are uncritical. They don't stand back and say, what is really happening here? They're uncritical because they take sides, like in a game, sports, you know, we take sides, you know, so Cork playing Tipperary, whatever, I'm going to wear a red jersey and shut up for Cork, and the referee will always be against Cork and so on and so forth. And that's grand, it's a bit of fun, something that it worked. But of course, the world isn't like that. So we have to be critical. And self-critical, analytical, and discuss and engage with the world from a fresh perspective, and be open to considering a wide range of alternative perspectives. And this is really important in relation to the huge global challenges that we're facing today. We have to consider different ways of living our lives. And even today on the radio, I was listening to somebody talk about carbon tax. And of course, carbon tax is a great idea until you have to pay it. And then it stops being a good idea. But in a sense, where we need people to start thinking and say, why is carbon tax important? And why is this that I have to make a sacrifice around this thing? And of course, it can be very, very difficult. And for some people, it's more difficult than others and so on and so forth. But we need to believe in a greater critique and a greater analysis. And that includes in the media and all of these things. We need to listen to the media and deal with the media in a more critical way. You know, not just take things at face value and things, you know, putting things into nice, neat packages and so on and so forth. It's great, good entertainment and all the rest, but it's not really getting to the root of what we should be thinking. I just want to talk about this idea of cognitive flexibility and cognitive rigidity, and this, I think this is a really important aspect of what adult education can achieve as well. So cognitive flexibility is the ability to shift cognitive set. That's really to be able to think outside the box, to be able to see the world in different ways, to be able to view people in different ways, to be able to view cultures in different ways, to be able to appreciate different kinds of identities, different ways of seeing the world. And like, this is so important in the contemporary world because we are surrounded by people who are absolutely certain about things. They're absolutely certain from political points of view, from religious points of view, and so on. So we see all these kind of fundamentalist thinking. These people absolutely know what's true in the world. Whether it's Donald Trump knowing for certain that he won the presidential election, or the Russians knowing for certain that Ukraine doesn't exist, or fundamental Christians knowing for certain that all their religions are wrong. It doesn't matter. It's all of these people who come to these fundamental views, and they try to persuade everybody else that there is only one truth, there's only one way of seeing the world. And if we get captured in that, we're never going to be able to resolve all the problems we're facing the world. In fact, we will find ourselves going back into a scenario of totalitarianism. And we can see that a lot of forces around that around the world, and a lot of these forces are coming to prominence. And adult education has a really important role to play there in giving people the tools to be able to critically analyze, to be able to think for themselves, and to be able to see through some of these fundamental lies. And the opposite side of this, Benedict talks about this, is a set of people whose outlook is usually provincial as a result of homogenous context. Now, this is a very interesting one because, ironically, the current era we live in, where there's so much availability of social media, for instance, it's easy to get into a silo. So you're only talking to people who share your views. So this leads to conflict rigidity, because you're not being challenged. Everybody in that space believes exactly the same things. They say exactly the same things. They all agree on everything. So there's no problem here. And then it's not considering that the situation is novel and requires a new strategy. So the world is constantly changing. And I keep hearing people talking about history repeating itself. History can't repeat itself. It's completely impossible. There are different people, different experiences, different times, different situations. Some historical events may look like each other. Trees look like each other. Human beings look like each other, but they're not exactly the same. And we need to be careful about being something to this idea of history repeating itself. It can't. It won't. It will never repeat itself. So we need to be always aware that the world is constantly changing. Today is different to yesterday. You know, after COVID, we had people say, go back to normal. No, what were they talking about? Like, what normal were they talking about? We go back to 2019, you know, and then we get back to 2019, we go back to 1819. Of course, we're going to start regressing. So it's important for us to realize that the world is constantly changing and we have to change with it. And if we're really facilitating people in their learning journeys, then we have to facilitate them to be able to think in different ways. And this was what I was just talking about a little bit earlier, which can be described as a rage against rationalism. Rage against rationalism is like this idea of kind of a denial of rationality, a denial of, you know, the real world. So this idea of fake news, for instance, is a kind of an example of that, where you say, instead of engaging with the actual material, you say it's lies. So you dismiss everything as lies. You say, this is the way of the world, and there's no other way of seeing the world. And she talks about the plethora of cultural as well as political and religious fundamentalism. So all of these things come up, and there is just one view of the world, there's only one right answer to everything, and that's hugely problematic. Hugely problematic. And as adult educators, we need to be very conscious that we don't, you know, enable that way of thinking. We try to break that down and give people the tools to be able to make decisions for themselves, choose for themselves, find their own analysis of things and engaging that. And through analysis and through debate and through discussion, we'll all get to better places. And a book concept about solving social problems through democratic self-obligation. And that's an interesting idea. The idea of self-obligation is interesting because what it's basically saying is that we obligate ourselves to make certain commitments to wider society, to our fellow human beings, that we step up and volunteer. We say, yes, I am prepared to make certain sacrifices. I am prepared to do certain things. I am obligating myself to do that because it's the right thing to do. And sometimes we forget about that as well. And people talk about human rights very often. They talk about human rights as entitlements. But of course, human rights also include obligations. So it's about that. A learning sovereign that exposes itself to a risky experimental practice of trial and error. So in other words, he's saying, it's not about us absolutely knowing everything. It's accepting that we don't know everything. And the only way we can figure things out is through trial and error, through experimentation, through debate with each other, through discussion, and then together we can get to a different place and maybe a better understanding and a better knowledge. And we have to include dissenting voices. So, no matter how non-linear, we have to listen to them.
We have to take on board that other people have different points of view, and we know that very often the dissenting voice is the one in time that's seen, you know, to prove to be the truer version of things. We need to include the marginalized and excluded minorities. So we need to make sure that everybody is heard, everybody is listened to, everybody can contribute. And then this is Habermas's idea around discursive legitimacy includes all concerned. Now, the idea of all concerned is important. And very often we make decisions for other people, but anybody who is impacted should be involved in the decision making. And if we apply this to education, we have to ask ourselves, to what extent are we including the learners in the design of our programs? And it's important we do. We include all the ones that are concerned in the design and ideally the delivery as well. Now, there are challenges here, it's not easy, but this is the direction we should really be trying to go. Reciprocally recognizes the equality of the views of everyone. So if I have a strong view on something, then I have to equally respect somebody else that has a strong view. And it shouldn't be the view of just this person who represents the most important person in the room. It should be everybody. So it's a reciprocal process. And the final point there is a really important one, is that all those engaged are open to complete reversibility. That means that if I engage in a process, that I am open to completely changing my point of view. Now, you listen to media interviews of politicians, and if the politician deviates one tiny iota from their position of 2 years ago, they're seen as flip-flopping, they're vacillating, and so on. This is exactly what they should be commended for. They should really be commended for having the courage to move on with their own learning and to come to a new place and a new understanding about something, rather than be held to account for some views they had 3 years ago. And it's a really problematic part of the media. It's good entertainment, but it's really against any kind of critical analysis of society. And we should be open to allowing politicians and everybody to change their minds and to learn and to come to a new place. So this was the idea from Habermas. So I just want to just finish up with two statements that come from UNESCO. And they both, I suppose, emphasize why adult education, lifelong learning, is really important and it needs to be part of a fundamental change. So saying, they're talking about the great global challenges around climate and migration and security and all these huge challenges. And they say they're for a fundamental change in the way people think and act. Solve these problems. And lifelong learning is a necessary part of making this change. So lifelong learning and adult education and learning is a critically important part of this process. We need to be facilitators of adults and giving them the tools, the mechanisms, the ways of thinking around these kinds of problems so that they can come to better places and better understanding and better knowledge around these issues. And that comes from 2014. And then now in the next one, we want to give you a preview of something that's in the making by UNESCO. It's not even out yet, but it's a draft document. But it's interesting, you know, to see how they frame the importance of what they are calling ALE, adult learning and education. So at a time when societies are threatened by rising fanaticism, and we see this. Violent extremism, we see this. Growing distrust in science, so we see this every day, you know, COVID doesn't exist. And rising inequalities, within and between countries. And learning and education can constitute a powerful policy response to constantly social cohesion, which is critically important, secure peace. We don't need to be reminded of that. Improve cultural understanding. In other words, that no single culture has a monopoly on, you know, what's best, or what's perfect. And that all cultures have a contribution to make. Improve, eliminate all types of discrimination. We see all kinds of discrimination. And unfortunately, we see more and more and more of it. And promote peaceful living together and active global and global citizenship. Peaceful living together is really important in terms of people coexisting together in a harmonious way. And I mentioned the war in Ukraine, and my first experiences in Ukraine were in Donbass region in 1995. And I went to Donetsk. I don't think I'd ever heard of it before that. I had not been to Ukraine before that. But one of the things that astounded me was the diversity in the city. There was a massive level of diversity. There were people from all over the world, different cultures, and so on and so forth. And everybody lived in a harmonious way. People respected each other, and so on. And you can see now where we've got to when that breaks down. So peaceful living together is really important. And active and global citizenship is important. So active citizenship is where people are really engaged around the decisions that impact them, whether it's at a local level or a global level. And again, adult education is really important here, because it's our responsibility to make sure as many people as possible have the tools to challenge given truths, to plot their own futures, to help society to evolve and move on and meet the challenges they have today. And I think in that regard, although the images may look different, the types of courses and things may be different, but the people who started this mission in ACE in 1946-47, they really had a very similar agenda. They were really about giving people an opportunity to not just better themselves, but to contribute to creating a better society and giving them the tools to do that. And we could see that in the outcomes of the graduates of that course. We could see how they proactively went and changed the world. And, you know, that's important. We all give them to change the world, provided we're given the opportunity to do it. And I think as adult educators, we should be giving more people the opportunity to change the world. So I'm going to wrap it up there. And if there are any questions or thoughts or whatever, I'm happy to hear them.
Just for institutions, a lot of fun.